about it. This is Ron. Hey, everybody. I want to give an update on a video I posted. Actually, a video posted went online over a year ago. And it's got a lot of attention lately. And the video is about an annual I was doing. And it's the first time this plane is coming to my shop. And no pre-buy was done. And I just started opening up this plane up. And found a whole bunch of obvious issues with this airplane. And I just want to respond to a few of the comments that I've read on what's going on with that airplane. One of the most common is, what happened to this airplane? Well, long story short, one, maybe two maintenance shops did the repairs after it left here. And there's two reasons for that. The first reason was the customer had unrealistic expectations of the time it's going to take to do the repairs, as well as the cost. And the next, well, actually more important thing was that instrument panel. If you haven't watched that video, I invite you to go back, watch that video all the way to the end, and look at that instrument panel. And keep in mind, the customer, not another mechanic, the customer did that to his instrument panel. And I did not realize the instrument panel was in that kind of condition until after the plane was in the shop. He had already left. And in fact, when he brought the plane to me, I didn't look at the plane for a couple of days. I put it in here, finished up another plane I was working on, then got to his. And first thing I did, open up the door to get the logbooks and start, evaluating the plane. And that's when I saw the instrument panel. Conversation with the customer revealed that he did that work himself and thought that was okay to do. In fact, I think the conversation kind of went in the direction that is, he did car stereos before in the past, it's no big deal. The same thing, just a couple more radios involved. We're not talking apples to apples here. For one, between a car and an airplane. And the next, as a owner of an aircraft, without any A&P license, really just a newly private pilot, that is not good. There's no way that was any stretch of imagination that's legal, safe. And yes, that plane did fly to me in marginal VFR conditions, just like you see it in the video. Well, that was the biggest strike with me working on this airplane, is I do not take on customers that are doing work on their own airplane like that. Main reason is, for example, I got an annual here I'm working on. If this is the kind of customer, and this isn't, but I do an annual on this airplane. This plane leaves, the customer decides he wants to do something, modify his airplane, just takes it upon himself. Something happens. That phase when I look at the logbook, who's the last mechanic signed off on the annual? Oh, it's this guy. I can't believe this guy signed off knowing this plane is in this kind of condition. That's the kind of scenario you run into. And if I got a customer that will take an airplane and basically hack and whack at it, or do any other kind of maintenance outside of what is considered preventative maintenance on an airplane that he is allowed to do, well, then my license is in jeopardy. And my license is my livelihood. This is how I make my living. So that was the biggest strike, me not working on this guy's airplane. And the second was, like I said, was the time frame he thought this plane can be worked on. I'm a one-man shop. And I knew I can't put all my resources on that plane every day for the next month on that plane. I got other customers that come in, So best case scenario on that was I'd have to work his plane in as I'm working other planes. So it's not just a thing I can just focus just strictly on his airplane, me being one man. If I had a couple people working for me, yeah, I could afford just throw one person, maybe two on that plane. Keep that process going along. So really I wasn't the right shop for him, and I told him that, and I was honest and upfront. I said, if you want me to work on this plane, I said, don't be surprised. It's 3 months, you know, maybe longer for me to actually go from start to completion on this. I got to work you in. That wasn't good for him. So I did. I contacted another shop on the field, let them know what was going on. They came down, looked at the plane, and they, you know, they're pretty surprised the condition an airplane can get in. But they were willing to take on the job. Yeah, the shop owner has a couple mechanics working for him. He could work it in a more timely fashion than what I could do. The next option was I contacted a couple local service centers, and I told them what I had. Unfortunately, the service centers were not on the field, so that'd be something we have to really consider if we're going to move the plane. You know, knowing what we know now, with the condition the plane was in, to fly it to another shop to have them work on it. And like I said, I was getting them, you know, as much leeway as I could on it, you know, as far as options. And at first he insisted me, he wanted to keep it with me, but he wanted me to work it faster than when I could, and I just had to put my foot down. I can't do it in the time frame you want. This is what it's going to cost to get it done, too. This is just some parts, what I'm looking at so far, and this is labor. I said, expect that to go up, you know, as more panels get removed and I get into the repairs. And that was already blowing his budget. And so at that point, we had just agreed. We both agreed, hey, it's better we take this plane to another shop. And I was really hoping he was going to take it to the shop that's here on the field. He paid me for the work that was done. I closed his plane back up, pushed it out of the hangar. He picked it up. And as I'm leaving, you know, this is on the weekend, I'm leaving the field. I see him taxi to the run-up area. Well, I thought he was going to taxi down to the other shop that was going to work on the plane, or that one of the options that he had. I couldn't watch. I just had to leave. Well, I had an idea. I'm pretty sure he flew the plane away. But it's confirmed when another shop contacted me about 2-3 weeks later. They saw my list of discrepancies on this airplane, my unairworthiness statement in the logbooks. And that shop said, there's no way I'm working all these items. And I said, well, that's between you and the customer. I said, I conducted an annual inspection. I found a list of items, made an unairworthiness statement in his logbook. We went over it. He's going to take it to another shop. You know, you work on whatever you feel comfortable working on, and you discuss it with the customer at that point. I mean, I'll wash my hands of the airplane. And, that was the end of it. You know, I didn't keep track of this airplane. I didn't keep track of where it was going. I didn't keep track of ownership. And by the way, if you did go to FlightAware or the FAA site and look up the N number, a different owner owns this airplane than the customer that I was dealing with. So please don't go, you know, bashing the poor customer that has it now. I feel pretty confident the plane was repaired and it's in airworthy condition. And that goes to another comment I keep hearing is, hey, scrap that airplane. You know, airplanes, if you're looking at an airplane and you're purely going by the economics of owning an airplane, you really shouldn't be owning an airplane. There's nothing economical about owning one of these things. It's purely for recreation, or some people actually use it for their business, and you know, still the economics are really hard to really justify unless your whole business is built on some type of air travel or instruction. But long story short, you see a car in that condition, yeah, by all means, scrap it. See an airplane in that condition, it can be repaired. And the airplanes, especially that year model, the over straight tail 182s, are getting more and more rare. A lot of people like them, and there's a lot of pros owning an airplane like that. Parts are still available, and the cost to repair that is not as much as you might think. You know, I was estimating somewhere around $20,000 to $25,000 to repair that airplane. If you got that airplane and it's, you know, immaculate condition. You know, talking about a value that's between $60,000 and $80,000 for that airplane. So you didn't actually blow the value of the airplane repairing it. Unless you paid $80,000 to begin with to buy that airplane, then your money's lost. But like I said, you don't buy an airplane for the economics of it. Anyways, some of the comments that come across I wanted to just address, and those were the biggest comments I had was, what happened to the airplane, and scrap it, why'd you let it in your shop that way, there's no way I would have worked on it, and I didn't work on it, but it wasn't because I couldn't handle it, it was because I couldn't do it in the time that he thought, or that he wanted his airplane back. And the kind of character this customer, you know, was that he would just work on his airplane, that's my red flag. Some shops can put up that kind of stuff. Myself, no. If you're going to work on your own airplane, that's pretty much a kiss of death with me. You know, unless you're doing, you know, owner preventative maintenance, oil changes, bearing repackings, you know, it's stuff like that that you're allowed to do. And when you're a pilot and you're getting a private pilot's license, that's part of the knowledge that you get, is what are you allowed to do as an owner. But when you go beyond that, and I can't convince you otherwise that, you know, this is not legal, when I show you in black and white what FAR 43 tells you what you can work on, and you still want to argue with me about it, yeah, you're done. You're done. I'm done. So, anyways, I hope that answers some of your questions. If you still got more questions about that airplane or that particular video, feel free to leave a comment and I'll try to respond as best I can with it. Other than that, go out there, be safe out there.